Shot in front of a live audience at Margarita Republic, it's Shots from the Bench. And now your hosts, Bob Waltman and Bob Murphy.
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to another edition of Shots from the Bench. It's only sports talk, and of course, all opinions are both fabulous and flawed. I'm Bob Wiltman. My partner's Bob Murphy, and Greg Malinzook's behind the scenes, working the cameras, doing the production, and trying to keep sanity. We're here at Margarita Republic in the beautiful Spanish Springs section of the Villages. Margarita Republic, where the food, fellowship, and fun are always seated first. We're here every Sunday from 2 to 3, so come on up, over, in, and out, or around whenever you're in the neighborhood. Stop by and join us. You can catch us on YouTube, to be sure, if you missed the show, but we sure love to have you. We like to throw out things to the audience and get them involved. And like I said, we are the only sports talk show in the Villages, and that's Shots from the Bench. And that being said, partner, I understand you have a Valentine's message that you'd like to pass on.
Well, you know what? I wouldn't think it would be appropriate. I wouldn't think it would be appropriate not to mention something about Valentine's Day on Valentine's Day. That's associated with Valentine's Day. Wouldn't you agree?
Makes sense to me.
Okay, yes. So I came up with my best love theme names in sports. How about that? Love theme names. Would you like to hear them?
I'd like to hear them because I don't know any.
First of all, happy Valentine's Day.
Well, thank you. Thank you.
I don't necessarily
I thought I was going to get a little more involved than that.
I have my top ten, and I have a couple others.
I like
my
this.
Top ten. Shall I proceed?
Let's hear.
Okay. My number ten is, now these are sports love theme names. Love, something to do with love, right?
All right.
Okay. Brandon Flowers, a cornerback for the San Diego Chargers. Okay. Anybody know Brandon Flowers?
I do know who Brandon Flowers is. Right. I like that.
Good player. Okay, number nine. The ladies will like this one. He's a pitcher for the Blue Jays, Scott Diamond.
Ooh, all right.
Diamond. So, you know, you got to have a diamond on.
Flowers, diamond.
Happens a lot on Valentine's.
We're starting high. Let's see where this is going.
There's a coach with the Houston Texans. His name is Romeo Crennel. Romeo Crennel. Think there's any association there with, I don't know. He's not my Romeo.
I like Romeo. No.
Okay, now here's one that everybody will recognize. Number seven is Pete Rose. Pete Rose. Okay, we're gonna get some roses for
one rose?
Valentine's Day. You gotta have Pete Rose in there.
Maybe put another him and Justin, maybe right. Another one.
Now this one's a little bit of a stretch, but not really a stretch. It's more of a nickname. Chris Crush Davis.
Chris Davis. Okay.
Crush.
Okay.
Now, Crush is to do with his home runs he's hitting.
I got it. Okay, that's his
but
nickname.
His name's Crush. So, you know, I don't have a crush on you, but I was just saying that Crush was one of them. Here's another one.
So far, not bad, I got to admit.
Number five is a WWE wrestler, Bret Hart. Bret Hart.
Certainly.
Can't go wrong with that one. Now, here's where they get good.
Okay.
Those are okay. Those are okay. But this is going to be good.
Whip it on me.
Are you ready?
Yes, sir.
All right. Number four, Lovie Smith.
Okay. Now we're getting
Lovie
somewhere.
Smith. Now he's a Lovie kind of guy.
Lovie Smith. All
Everybody
right.
loves him. Everybody loves him.
I like that. Now we're getting to Valentine. That's what we're talking.
That's why, you know, he's a good, you know, whatever. Number three, Kevin Love. I mean, how can you go wrong with that?
You can't go wrong
Kevin
with that.
Love. He's
in fact, I want to hear the ones that are better than Kevin Love. That's what
I got some. I got some better than Kevin Love.
Okay.
Number two, Davis Love the III. Golfer.
Three times.
He's loved by a lot.
You got to like that. That's
Davis
right. I like
Love
that.
The III. And my number one sports theme name, Bobby Valentine.
Can't be.
How can you go wrong with that?
That is a legitimately good list.
Now, those are my names. Now, there's a couple of things you could read into this. Like, for instance, if you look at your husband and you call him Mr. Wright, I have another name. There could be David. You could call him David Wright. Right? Or say you want to send your love a teddy bear, you could go to the Vikings camp and get Teddy Bridgewater to send them one. Okay? I just wanted to throw those out.
I'll tell you what.
Get this off my chest.
I would have gone in a different direction. Mine would have been all candy. That's how cheap I am. That would have been, you know.
Well, we can go down that road, too.
Reese Witherspoon or something. That's where I would have gone. I'd gone in a totally different
direction.
I like
direction. That one.
Well, that's about like as cheap that. As it
I mean,
gets.
That's good off the top of your head there.
Peter Paul and Mary or Peter Paul and Mounds. I would have come up with something.
That's right.
But that's almost strictly candy, no diamonds for me.
So anyway,
I love it.
If you talk about Charles Barkley, the round mound or rebound or whatever. Yeah. Okay,
well,
so that was it. That was how to get it off my chest.
That's a great one. It's a great way to start off the Valentine's show. But let's talk a little bit about the Super Bowl. It's a Super Bowl wrap-up. I know I got shut out, and I picked Carolina by 2.5 touchdowns, and I only missed by 4 touchdowns.
No, I pissed. I was a little, not quite as bad as that, but I was pretty close.
I was amazed and surprised. Well, I shouldn't have been surprised, but I was amazed at how easily Denver's defense was able to dominate Carolina.
That was the key. I mean, you know, we knew both defenses were pretty good, but we didn't think one would totally dominate a game like that.
I didn't see that coming. I thought that Carolina had played some pretty good defenses through the year. And seemed to have an answer for all of them. They were just absolutely shut down.
It just seems as the more that, you know, that Carolina was a cocky team.
Yeah.
And when they came in there and they were getting you know, knocked to the ground like they were, I think it flustered them.
Well, I think you're right. But they're cocky because nobody could do that to them all year.
Right.
And all of a sudden, they're on the big show, the big dance floor, and boom, they're getting manhandled. I mean, manhandled.
Cam Newton did not like to be thrown to the ground, did not have the ball stripped out of his hands.
No, he was. He hadn't been treated that roughly during the year.
No. And so that was a defensive performance for the ages, really.
Well, it was. When you consider the caliber of offense that we're up against and to shut them down that decidedly, I can't deny with your analysis is right on the money. I think it's that's got to go down as one of the better shutdown defensive performances
in
the Super Bowl.
Reminded me of Pittsburgh against Minnesota back in the day.
Sure.
Vikings were back then a great, pretty good offensive team. Couldn't do a thing. They had Fran Tarkenton and Ahmad Rashad and Chuck Foreman, and couldn't do a thing.
Well, yeah, I said, and the Ravens, I think, had a shutdown defensive win in one of their Super Bowls, too. Mm-hmm. But recapping the Super Bowl, I want to just focus on four of the key players and just to get your thoughts. First, let's talk about Peyton Manning, because I think he'd be nuts if he didn't go out on top like this, but I thought that he played an adequate game.
Yeah.
But the way his defense was playing, all he had to do was take care of the ball, and except for one tragically errant pass, he played a pretty controlled, smart game, I thought. Yeah.
He had a ball stripped out of his hand, a la Cam Newton as well.
Yes, he did.
But overall, I think he except for that one pick, he didn't. He moved. He actually made some good throws at times. He didn't make a lot of them, but he made a couple of good ones.
He made a couple. I'll tell you, the first drive, he came down. Yeah. But I think as he throws on the break about as well as anybody. But boy, if he has to zing it in there, I think his arm's not quite where it used to be. And not that that's a guy's almost 40. It's not. That's the way it is with all of us. But
I saw him on a talk show after the Super Bowl with Magic Johnson on the panel.
Yeah.
And he was saying he'd like to get him to come play in Los Angeles,
We'll see.
We'll see.
But that's Peyton Manning. And one of the other guys I wanted to talk about while we were talking about the dominant defense of the Denver team was Von Miller.
Oh, yeah.
I knew Von Miller was a good player, but a good player rises to the occasion. And I don't think you can see anybody dominate a game like he dominated that game defensively.
Right.
So my hat's off to him. And wouldn't you know, he's a free agent.
Yeah.
You don't think somebody's going to cough up a ransom to get him for a couple years?
Oh,
they're
absolutely
going to.
That's right.
But he's a smart boy. He took advantage of the opportunity on the national tube to get it taken care of. So all for him.
And I also want Von Miller. Von Miller, you just won the MVP. Where are you going to go?
He's going to go to.
I'm going to go to Disney World.
Disney World. That's exactly right. Hey, the guy I wanted to talk about, and you probably have his name down. Is I want to say Tariq Abdul. Is that right? Or Abdul Tariq? I can't remember.
Or you know, I know his name's Tariq.
That's Tariq. About, okay. Well, I want to talk about Tariq.
I don't know his first name.
Because Tariq.
Khalib.
That's right.
Khalib Talib.
Khalib Tariq. And somebody did what they should have done to Beckham. The fact of the matter is, they took him out of the game when he got a couple personal foul penalties, and the coaches took him out and sat down and said, "This is only the Super Bowl. It's not time to be out there being a clown." And I thought that worked out
great. What, he had three in a row?
Yeah, and then he came back in and he played a good, solid, great defensive
game. They calmed him down.
And that's what you got to do when you have somebody that's out of control like that.
Sure.
And it's only the Super Bowl, so you think maybe that the coaches took it seriously? I think they did.
Yes.
So I thought that was great. And finally, I want to talk about Cam Newton. I thought that Cam had a great season. I thought he had a particularly rough game. And I really did not like the fact that he decided to punk out on the press conference. I think that if you're going to enjoy all of the accolades heaped on you in all the press conferences, you got to be ready to take it on the chin when you have a bad performance. And I felt bad that he decided
that. Well, I couldn't agree with you more on that. But you know what? You know, I've changed my opinion. I was really mad at him, the way he acted. Act like a jerk, act like an idiot. But you know, he's a young guy, and he's still immature in some ways. He's got all the talent in the world. But let's as the dust settles after the Super Bowl, because I was like, what? How can you act like that?
I give him a pass too, but
well, let's
give
see
him
how
one,
he goes from
him
here.
One pass, because I got news for him. He's going to have a lot of successes, but you got to be able to handle the failures as well as you handle the
successes.
There's
a lot of Hall of Famers and people who have been there before him who have counseled him after this.
Sure.
And let's see how he matures through this thing.
Well,
that's what we'll judge him. Keep an eye on him.
And in the meantime, we're going to see how he matures as we get into the second quarter. So we will be back with the second quarter Shots from the Bench right after this. All right, we are back with the second quarter of Shots from the Bench here at Margarita Republic in the beautiful Spanish Springs section of the Villages. Margarita Republic, where the food, fellowship, and fun are always seated first. And partner, this is your time to shine, because at this time of the sports year, the only thing that's going on that I want to pay attention to is the NBA. We got the All-Star Game. We had all the other games that are associated with the All-Star Game, and I know you're on top of them. How about let's go on over a rundown and see what we got?
Well, this is NBA All-Star Weekend. Friday night. Friday night, it's a big deal in the NBA. I like to watch it. On Friday night, they start off with the first-year players, rookies, against the second-year players.
All right.
And this year, they split that between the American team and the internationals, because we have so many young international players that are first or second year players.
Makes sense.
So that turned out to be a great game. Some of the young stars like Porzingis and Herzogna, you know, for the international team, and of course all the great young rookies like Okafor and Towns, you know, for the U.S. team. So it was a great game to watch. There wasn't much, like most All-Star games, there wasn't much defense.
Not much
played.
Defense. A lot of shooting.
A lot of driving to the basket for dunks.
Sure, absolutely.
Like a 150-something scored, a 150-something. But great
Why
to
not?
Watch.
The last no
fourth
defense,
quarter, played a little defense toward down the stretch to try to win the game. And so that was fun to watch. And then last night, they had these, you know, the skill challenge, which is basically you dribble through a bunch of cones, and then you pass it for accuracy. Make a pass through a cone accuracy.
Makes sense.
And then you dribble down the other end of the court and make a layup.
All right.
Okay.
All right.
And then also make a 3-point shot. And how quick you can do that under by timing. So it got down to a big man, Carl Anthony Towns, a rookie.
Wow.
Against Isaiah Thomas, the point guard. Now, usually the Usually
the point guard
handles the ball better, shoots the ball better, the ball better.
Yeah.
Well, this is the first time in NBA history that they've had this, that a big man actually beat Isaiah Thomas, and he beat him on a three-pointer because they were both going for their three-pointers, and he was the first one to hit the three-pointer. And so hats off to Carl Anthony Towns winning the skills challenge. It was fun to watch. Really
I would
was.
Think a big guy would be at a disadvantage. That's a heck of an achievement. Yeah.
And now the three-point shooting got down to the finals between teammates Steph Curry and Klay Johnson.
There's a surprise.
And, oh, man, Klay Johnson wanted to beat him bad. You know, he just wanted to beat him really bad. And got down to Curry being in the lead late in the final. And pretty much Klay Thompson had hit all of his shots to win. And he hit all of his shots to win. And it was just crazy, the shots he was hitting. So that was one of the best I've ever seen. Now, the slam dunk was last night as well. And, you know, I was told you I wasn't going to watch it because I've seen just about every dunk that you can see.
That's kind of the way I feel. The dunk's not – I'm not going to usually watch the dunk contest.
So, you know, I stayed and watched. It got down to Zach LaVine, the point guard from the Minnesota Timberwolves, and Aaron Gordon, the power forward for the Magic, Orlando Magic.
All right.
And I tell you, it was great. It was one of the best I've ever seen. They were going at it one after the other after the other. I think Aaron Gordon got stiffed, to be honest with you, because he did some shots. They had Magic, the mask art for the Magic, stand there, and he jumped. He was holding the ball over his head, and he jumped over the top of him and grabbed it and did threw his legs into in a reverse dunk. I've never seen anything. It was the most amazing one I've ever seen.
That's athleticism.
And Shaquille O'Neal was one of the judges, right?
Yeah.
So he's like there with all these judges, and he's the only one that gave him a 9 on that dunk. And I don't know if it had something to do with his – everybody was thinking it had something to do with his – he had something wrong with the Magic in his brain or something. But that cost him to win it, and then it went the distance, and Zach LaVine won it. But it was a great complimentary
I mean, that's just all for fun. But like I said, a perfect example of Shaq judging the dunk contest. I mean, I don't think Shaq was going to put a whole of exciting dunks in. I think he's just going to jump up and throw it down as hard as he can.
Yeah.
But that's just a showing off the great athleticism these guys have, and they do have unbelievable gifts. Unbelievable gifts.
I have a sports trivia question based on that dunk contest last night.
Let's hear it.
The first NBA dunk contest.
First NBA dunk contest.
Was who and what year was it? That would
you
be
mean
my
who won it?
Yeah, who won it?
Well,
and what year
question.
Was it?
That's I'm my gonna trivia. Say I'm gonna say because the guy from the Hawks, I'll never forget his name now.
Are you thinking of should I say? Are you thinking of Dominic Wilkins?
Yes. How about Dominique Wilkins or
David
Thompson?
That's very good. You're real close.
That's
close, real good. I mean, that's around the time. No, actually, it was, should I say it?
Yeah, heck yeah.
It was Michael Jordan in 1987.
All right.
But you're right there. I mean, you're right close to what that would be.
Boy, then I win the prize. If I was right there, I should
get
it.
Well, no, you weren't right there.
All right.
So,
story of my life right there.
But, you know, and then tonight, of course, is the NBA All-Star game at 7.
So tonight's the game.
Kobe Bryant's last All-Star game as a player.
But he's going to play.
He's going to play.
Okay.
He's going to play. He's 5 NBA titles, top 5 in scoring in the NBA, one of the greatest of all times, one of the best defenders of all time, never mind scorer.
Great. A lot of people don't realize he really is an exceptional defensive player.
Oh, absolutely.
He's got the longest arms. He is just unbelievable.
Even at the age he is now, which I believe he's 40, close to 40.
He's 39, close to
39, 40. 39,
40.
He's averaging 17 points a game. He can't do it night in, night out, but every other game he's scoring 30 over 30 points, and then he'll have a 15-point game or a 9-point game, and then he's back to 40 points or 30 points. Just can't do it all the time.
No.
When his body regroups a little bit, then he's able to do it. So what a great career.
He did have a great career.
So many players designed their games after him.
Well.
You know, you can look at, like, even LeBron. Well, he designed his over probably Michael Jordan, and then other players like LeBron James looked up to him as well. So But what a great career. That's what's going on this weekend in the NBA. Also, another thing that happened was we'll have to get into it in the next quarter.
Okay.
But we're going to get into it is the NBA Hall of Fame finalists for
2000.
They're not the ones that are being chosen yet, but they're the finalists.
Okay.
Worth talking about real quick. I don't know if we have time right now to mention them.
We got time.
Oh, we got a few minutes?
Okay. Yeah.
As far as the players go, we have Shaquille O'Neal. No argument there. 19 seasons.
Shaquille's going to make it.
19 seasons, 24 points a game, 11 rebounds, 2.5 blocks a game. He won 4 NBA titles, 3 in a row with the Lakers. Too bad that relationship didn't stay with Kobe there. Probably could have been more. But 3 with the Lakers and 1 with the Miami Heat and Dwayne Wade.
I wondered where the other one was. That makes sense. Yeah.
Yep.
Okay.
And 15-time NBA All-Star, Shaquille O'Neal.
Not bad.
Still on TV as an NBA analyst. Great personality.
I kind of like him. Like him in commercials.
It's funny.
I like him.
Sure.
I think he's a very marketable talent.
Oh, yeah.
I like him.
Allen Iverson, point guard from the Sixers.
Ooh, Allen Iverson.
9-time All-Star. 14 seasons in the NBA, 4-time scoring champ in the NBA, MVP 2001 when they went to the finals, lost to the Bulls. Either Portland or the Bulls that year.
Okay.
I don't remember myself. 6.5 assists a game. One of the best games I've ever seen was when I was in Orlando. The Magic had Tracy McGrady. And it was Iverson going off for 40-something points and Tracy McGrady going off for 40-something points in a real shootout down in Orlando. And that was one of the best games I've ever been to. He had a knack of going inside against bigger players and just scoring it and never get stopped by the big player. I never saw a guard
incredibly quick.
Able to score among big, tall players than Allen Iverson for such a small guy. And he had that famous rant about practice. Remember? Frank Caliendo did a big thing on him.
I'm going to stop just for a second. I said, and we'll go into the next quarter to talk about it. But I'm not – I have nothing against Allen Iverson being in the Hall of Fame. I think he's a fantastic guard. I think he should be in the Hall of Fame. That being said, I think he promoted the sport in a negative way in the sense – it was almost – like a gang related type of thing. I can't deny him his skills. Mm-hmm. I can't deny him his talent. I can't deny him his successes. But I jot his whole attitude. I mean, I don't think if you were to take your kids to a game, you didn't want your kid to be like Allen Iverson. At least that's the way it seemed to me.
Yeah, I can see your point on that.
Found him a little difficult. So
right. Well, he. Yeah, he had this edge to him for sure.
Yeah.
This hip-hop, gang-related hip-hop,
hip-hop's a good
whatever.
Phrase. He had a hip-hop edge to him.
I could see that, too.
It bothered me watching him play because I think guy's got all the talent in the world, and don't you think you could just smile a little bit and say something decent once in a while?
Yeah, you know what?
That's my rap on Iverson.
Well, I could see that. You know,
little humor from the producer. You can't beat that. That's the rap on Iverson.
to balance that, which is true, a player said that the guy had one of the biggest hearts ever to play as a teammate to play with.
Oh, I said there's no question.
You know,
as a basketball player.
I know what you're saying, though.
But
that makes
I'm saying
sense.
And it's not his job to be a role model.
Sure.
I think he also was quoted as saying, I'm not supposed to be a role model. Well, unfortunately, you're getting that much money to play basketball.
Right. If you ever get a chance to watch comedian Frank Caliendo do Allen Iverson practice, you owe it to yourself as a sports fan to go on YouTube and look up Frank Caliendo, Allen Iverson. It's one of the most funniest things you've ever seen. And it's so right on what happened during a press conference one time with Allen Iverson. So, anyway.
Well, I'll tell you what, we've got a lot more to talk about. We're going into halftime. We're going to get on Greg's case about some of the side comments coming thrown at us. They're not as funny as he thinks they are, but that's okay. We're going to take our hits, too. So we'll be back with more of the Hall of Fame and the candidates, and we'll be talking about a lot more things. I got some rants about some of the other stuff that's been going on, and we'll be back with the second half of Shots from the Bench right after this. We are back with the second half of Shots from the Bench here at Margarita Republic in the beautiful Spanish Springs section of the Villages. Margarita Republic, where the food fellowship and fun are always seated first. And let's continue where we left off. We were talking about the Basketball Hall of Fame candidates.
Right.
And we got about halfway through. Who else you got on that
list? Well, we had Iverson and O'Neal.
Yeah.
O'Neal. And now we're the third player on the list. This is the Basketball Hall of Fame.
Right.
And it is Kevin Johnson, the point guard.
KJ. Yes.
That's right. Very good.
Hey, I watched him a little bit.
You know, whenever you watched him play, they'd always say he's one of the most popular players in the NBA, and he still is today. You know, he's actually the mayor of Sacramento today.
I didn't know that.
Since 2008.
Who knows that? That's
pretty
neat.
He's the mayor of Sacramento, California.
That's pretty neat. I like that.
He played his first year in Cleveland, and then the next 11 of his 12 seasons with the Phoenix Suns.
I didn't even know he started in Cleveland.
He played with Dan Marley and Charles Barkley and all that team back then. And made the playoffs,
Very
many years,
good.
The finals, whatever.
Great player.
Three-time All-Star, 18 points a game, 9 assists, 2 steals a game. Hardly ever turned the ball over. He's a good addition as well, I think.
Oh, yeah.
You know? And then after those three players, we're getting into, as far as the Basketball Hall of Fame, they've got some coaches on the list.
All right.
Lefty Driesel.
Oh, Lefty Driesel.
Remember Lefty Driesel? Well, you know, Lefty Driesel.
Tuck your shirt in, Lefty.
That's right. he's the originator of Midnight Madness.
Oh, he was the guy that set it up?
Yeah, set up the practices. As soon as that clock turned 12:01, when they can start, because they can't start practicing for a certain time.
Right.
He had his teams doing that, and it turned out to be a wave across the country. He was the first one to ever do that.
He's innovative.
Yeah. And he was the only coach to win 100 games with 4 different schools. And that's a trivia question for the crowd, or if anybody's interested.
I think that's a great question. I didn't know that.
He was coached 4 schools, 100 wins each, okay? Only coach to do that. And he's 8th all-time in victories in NCAA history. So Lefty Driesel, he's 83 years old now.
He's made his mark. Is he still? He's not still coaching.
No.
Okay.
No, he's sitting home with Mama on Valentine's Day.
Good for him. That's what he should be doing.
That's right. And the other coach, one of the coaches was Eddie Sutton. Eddie Sutton,
Arkansas,
4-time NCAA Coach of the Year. He was 7th all-time in victories, 3 Final Fours, 6 Elite Eights, 12 Sweet 16s. Did a lot of it with Oklahoma State as well.
Right. I was going to say, I would have thought he'd be a candidate for maybe 100 wins with 4 schools, but I guess he only coached in 3.
But that's pretty good. 12 Sweet 16s, 6 Elite Eights, and 3 Final Fours.
Not bad.
Not bad at all.
Not bad at all. Well, good. I'm glad
Eddie Sutton.
I'm glad he's getting recognized.
Yep.
Yeah.
And then Tom Izzo. Kind of surprised that he's on this list because I think he's still coaching.
He's not only still coaching, he's a pretty young man.
Michigan State.
Yeah, but he's had a spectacular college career.
I think Jim Calhoun was actually inducted, and Jim Boeheim, and they're still coaching. Boeheim's coaching.
Calhoun's retired. Boeheim's, I think,
but they were invited. They were inducted while they were coaching, I believe.
Oh, yeah. So, well, that.
Yeah. Tom Izzo, Michigan State, 7 Final Fours, 18 straight NCAA appearances.
Okay. 18 straight.
18
think about
straight.
That.
That's pretty, that's pretty awesome.
That's ridiculous. That's, is what
I think
that
that's
is.
Why he's still around, don't you think?
He must be able to get. That's phenomenal.
I don't
phenomenal.
Know anybody has done that.
No.
One NCAA title in 2000. So, you know, hats off to him for that. Bo Ryan, a current coach of Wisconsin, won 4 Division III championships with Wisconsin Platteville. You've heard of them, right?
I've heard of Wisconsin Platteville. I almost went there.
Oh, yeah, that's one.
I didn't know.
You know, one of the big powerhouses. But, hey, he won three championships with them, four Big Ten championships, and two Final Fours. So that's Bo Ryan. I think, as I was putting this together, I think I heard, correct me if I'm wrong here, something about him stepping down or retiring after this year or now or something. I don't
know. I'll tell you what, I hadn't heard. But
something's going on with him right now. I don't know
okay.
what's going on.
Well, maybe he is. You probably, you've got your finger on the pulse.
I just happened to hear something, and I'll get back to you on that one.
All right.
One referee is in, Daryl Garrison.
Daryl Garrison.
Right.
Like I said, when basketball really started making the big transformation to television, we were talking about off camera about Mendy Rudolph, and the only other referee I can probably name by name is Daryl Garrison.
That's right.
The two big
Iron Man.
Two big guys that I knew. Yeah.
That's right. So, 27 years as an NBA official.
I actually know him to see him. If you put him on the screen, I'd say that's Daryl Garrison.
Oh, sure. That face is very recognizable.
Heck yeah, it is.
1,798 regular season games, 269 playoff games, and 41 finals games.
So it's like 2,000.
A little experience there, I think.
2,000 games. Do you think I would get a little old? Just a little.
We need to get him as a guest on the show.
I don't know.
I hope he's alive.
I suspect he is. I haven't heard much about Daryl's demise. But can you imagine 2,000 games? Oh, my gosh. That's incredible.
That's quite an Ironman career and one of the best of all time, for sure. Definitely worthy of being in the Basketball Hall of Fame.
And people don't think about that, but the officials have to do their job. To make the Hall of Fame, you not only got to be good at what you do, you got to be exceptional at what you do. So
speaking of being qualified to be in the Hall of Fame, Basketball Hall of Fame, one player that kind of sticks out to me as not being picked this year, maybe in the last couple of years, is George McGinnis. Growing up, I watched the ABA play.
Indianapolis, right?
A lot of those players, Dr. J.
Sure.
Dr. J and George McGinnis were the two best players in the ABA.
Connie Hawkins.
These players transitioned into the NBA, when they did the merger.
Absolutely.
Pacers went in. That's a trivia question. Who were the teams that, ABA teams that came into the... to the NBA?
I could get half of them, maybe.
I could probably get half of them, too, but I just thought of it.
But George McGinnis was the dominant.
The Spurs were another team.
He was the dominant player. George McGinnis was an unstoppable forward Indiana, right?
Indiana Pacers.
Yeah, absolutely.
San Antonio Spurs. Yeah. George Gervin.
The Iceman. Absolutely.
Okay. But he's in that group.
I was going to say, but he's in that,
He's in that group of players, and he hasn't been. And apparently, from what they're saying, is a lot of these committee members look down their nose at the ABA players, and I think that's wrong. That's my commentary here. He played 10 seasons. I guess injury caught him. But 10 seasons, he averaged 25 points a game, 13 rebounds, 3 assists. Almost 4 assists for a big man. First 6 seasons were in the ABA, and the rest with the Philadelphia Sixers and Denver.
Denver, okay.
Okay, he had some ABA, So hats off to him. I should say hats off to him. In the NBA, he averaged 22 points a game and 12 rebounds.
Wow.
So, I think I'm rooting for him. I think his day will come.
What's holding it back? Why?
We got these people that...
just because he's in the ABA for 6 years?
It appears that way. That's what the commentary is about him.
Wow.
Because he played more time in the ABA than the NBA.
But you said he did 22 points a game in the NBA.
Yes, he did.
Holy mackerel. I mean...
Yeah. He had 4 seasons in the NBA.
Only
4. So that could be what the reason. But, his body of work, and some of those teams were very fun to watch. In the ABA.
Oh, my gosh, yeah.
I mean, they are high-scoring games and very high. See, you took those talents when they came into the NBA. Obviously, he had the skill to play in the NBA. So I'd like to see him again. That's my little rant on
that. All right, well, I think you're entitled to it. It makes sense to me.
Yeah. And
while we're talking the ABA, and I'll get off the side, just I played at the time the ABA was flourishing, and I hated playing with that ball. hated that color.
Did you really?
Yes.
I used to love it. When I first started playing with it, I thought it was a lot of fun on the playground to play
like
with it.
It was bigger. I didn't like the way it felt.
I know what you're thinking. You know, you think the spin is going to bother you, or the rotation is messing you up or something.
Yeah, but you know what? It was the same stinking ball, but sure. You could use it as an excuse. Well, I missed it because it's an ABA ball.
Remember when we were out in the schoolyard and your friend came, hey, I got an ABA ball.
I know.
Oh, cool.
I got an ABA ball.
Let's play with that.
Okay,
you know?
Like I said, if I missed a layup, I'd say, well, it's that stupid ABA ball.
Oh, okay, that was the reason.
I can't make a basket with that ball.
So. I'll tell you, I used to love playing on the schoolyard when they had the chain nets. You know,
chink.
In one way I liked it, in one way I didn't like it, okay? I didn't like it because I could jump pretty good back then, and my fingernails would get caught sometimes, and they actually almost rip your fingers off if it got locked in there as you were jumping and coming back down. But I also loved the sound of it when you hit your J, and it went, chink. You know, chink. It sounded great.
Well, I didn't have to worry about breaking my hands because I couldn't touch the net. That's how high I could jump. I could, if I ran the length of the court and sprang, I could touch the net. Well, I'll tell you what. That's an interesting comment on my collegiate and high school basketball career. That being said, we are done with the third quarter. We got a lot more to go in the fourth quarter, so stay with us. We'll be back with Shots from the Bench right after this. Okay, we are back with the fourth and final quarter of Shots from the Bench. And like I said, we're handling a little bit of the basketball. It's a basketball weekend because of the NBA All-Star Game and all of the playing games for that, the specialty games. But let's just talk about how the teams are doing in the league so far right now. Give us a quick rundown of where they are, Bob.
Well, we're down to the last 30 games of the season.
Okay.
Approximately. So, in the Eastern Conference, the Cavs are still number one. Raptors, number two, right behind them. Celtics moved up to the number three spot. And they're looking to make, and this is, we're getting close this weekend also. Not only do we have all the activities in the NBA, but we've got the NBA trade deadline coming up this Thursday.
Okay.
And so that's a lot of whispers going on about that, which we'll get to in a second real quick.
All right.
Hawks are number four. Hawks are looking to make a deal. Celtics are looking to make a deal to improve their standing. The Heat, potentially, because they're in the number five spot in the East. They have a free agent, Whiteside. They're a great shot-blocking center. They don't want to lose him for nothing over the summer. They may try to trade him. The Celtics are looking to improve. There's been talk of Kevin Love going to him. There's been talk of Blake Griffin going to them. There's a lot of rumors going on.
But food for thought. But aren't the Clippers they're still in contention, right? They're doing fine. Why would they want to get Rhino? Well, I know he's been hurt. He's acting kind of goofy.
We'll get to the Western Conference in a minute. Right. But yes, the Clippers are having issues with Blake Griffin and he punched an assistant coach.
I'd say he's had an
equipment manager.
Problems.
And among other problems that he's run into, quite frankly, they're sick of his routine, and they as good as he is, and he's one of the top players in the NBA.
Yeah,
they're looking for a deal. If they could bring in a Carmelo Anthony, I don't think this is going to happen, but they would take him. They would take him, even though there's an age difference between them. They would take him, and the Knicks would be glad to get Blake Griffin. At least as a Knicks fan, I would be. But anyway, so that's – I don't want to jump the gun.
No, I didn't mean to.
So that's what's going on in the Eastern Conference, you know, the Cavs, Raptors, Celtics. We have a new number eight in the eighth spot because the top eight make the playoffs.
Yeah.
The Hornets, who were out of the mix –
they're on a winning streak. I've been following them.
And,
they've been winning all of a sudden,
you know, they're playing great ball.
Yeah.
They're in the number eight spot. They were in the playoffs last year. So, they're back into that contention there. So keep an eye on those are your top eight in the Eastern Conference.
All right.
The Western Conference, Warriors, are shooting for 70, trying to beat 72 wins.
I think they're going to do it, too. I mean, they look to me like they could have 75 wins.
We've got a long break for the All-Star, until next Thursday, Friday. But they're 48-4. the Spurs, 45-8, 3.5 games back. 45-8, 3.5 games back.
Fire the coach, that's what I say.
The Warriors have taken on all challengers. They've taken on the Spurs, the Thunder, the Cleveland Cavs, and beaten them in the last 2 weeks.
Yeah.
And so everybody that is a threat to them, they've beaten it in the last 2 weeks. So the Thunder, the Clippers. Now the Clippers are 13.5 games back in the fourth spot in the West. Got a good chance of being in the playoffs, obviously. But with this Blake Griffin situation, they're looking to possibly deal him, and I don't know how that would affect the dynamics of that team or whether they'll even do it. These rumors are out there. The big rumor that came out this weekend, the big rumor over the weekend, was a proposed three-team trade between the Knicks, the Cavs, and the Celtics. Kevin Love would have gone to Boston, Carmelo Anthony to Cleveland, and the Knicks would pick up draft picks and some other trivial players. Good draft picks, by the way.
So you're saying want Carmelo in Cleveland?
Well, right. This is what the rumor was over the weekend. Apparently, the Knicks would have been up for trading this, but Carmelo Anthony has a no-trade clause in his contract, and he does not, so he says through the media, he does not want to be traded now. So we'll see. And then we got other players this week that are hinted around of being drafted, like Dwight Howard in Houston.
Is it just me? I'm kind of up to here with Dwight Howard.
Yeah. Nobody really wants him.
Every time I watch him, I'm not sure. He sure looks like he's physically gifted, but how good he looks, he sure doesn't. He doesn't play as big as he looks.
He was with the Magic, they ran the offense through him.
Yeah.
Okay. They passed down low. He either curled to the basket and made it pass, or he'd throw out to 3-point shooters. And which made that team go. Every place he's been since, with Kobe Bryant, with James Harden, he's not the center anymore. Those guys are. And when he's not the center, he's not the dominant player used to be.
I just don't see what the big deal is, but that's me.
On the NBA, I was telling you last week, the team to watch out for was the Trailblazers. They were not in the playoff hunt as of a week ago. They are now number 7. They moved up to 7 instead of 8, not even 8, they're 7. Their backcourt of Lillard and C.J. McConnell have really taken off, McCollum. And so that's the new, the Spurs, number 2, Thunder, Clippers. So that's my quick NBA chest.
I'd like to know. We got to see it. While we're talking basketball, I think it's been an interesting week. I've got a couple points I made about the Associated Press Top 25. You got Villanova.
Yep.
What happened to that T-shirt? It fell. We had a big Villanova T-shirt.
Oh, yeah?
There you go. So all you Villanova fans, number 1. Villanova going all the way.
They had a dunk fest against St. John's yesterday, that's for sure.
St. John, that's another. Well, I'll be talking about them in a couple of minutes because that's tragic. But Villanova, but let's take a look at some of these upsets.
Sure.
Oklahoma got beat. Wisconsin beat number 2 Maryland. Duke beat number 7 Virginia.
Yep.
I see that Texas lost and Wichita State lost. What I'm saying is the AP Associated Press men's rankings of the 25 top college basketball teams, it's going to really, really make a move. I see North Carolina's wiping up Pitt on a big screen here, so they'll probably get back into they'll probably get up in the top 5, which is probably where they belong.
Yeah, they're number 9 now, I believe.
Yeah, but they've beaten a couple fairly good teams, so that's rather decisive.
Sure.
Kansas beat Oklahoma.
Kansas is going to move up.
Kansas will
sure.
be like I said.
That's the best game of the week.
They'll be back where they were. That was a great game, by the way.
I watched that game. I tried to watch at least one of the top games over the weekend, and that was a great game.
And I like to watch teams that are totally undisciplined. That's why anytime West Virginia's on, you want to see a team that doesn't even need a coach, Because they do whatever they want to do. Right. They don't care if they lose. The coach just kind of calls them and says, okay, we're going to do this, and they go, right. Then they go out and do whatever the heck they want.
Interesting point real quick on the Duke win over Virginia.
Yep, guy threw a banker at the end.
You know, Grayson Allen, that was a very controversial shot, you know. I mean, he went up for the shot. He came driving down with hardly any time left, down into the lane, jumped up in the air. As he was coming down, and it appeared his foot, if he came down, it's double dribble. You know, he's traveling.
Okay.
His foot touches the ground as he's releasing the shot. If that was really inspected, I think that could have been reversed. I really do.
Are they allowed to reverse a call?
That was
at
Duke,
like that?
Right? That was at Duke?
Yeah.
I don't think that was going to happen at Duke.
Can you even...
Can you imagine if they did that?
Can you actually reverse a non-call and an up and down or a travel? I don't think
they have instant replay. You know,
yeah, but
they've got instant replay for other things.
Okay.
Is his line on the line? No, it wasn't.
No, that's what I mean. It wasn't called.
Right.
There's nothing to do about it. Yeah.
If you watch the replay, it was extremely close. I mean, it looked like as he was coming down, that foot was he's releasing the ball as that toe was hitting the ground, and it was so close. Well, whatever. It was a good shot either way.
But
it could have been a foul too from that Duke fan over there.
The Duke fan. We like Duke fans.
Could have been a foul too.
We're
That's
all for
right.
Duke fans.
If they did a replay, they would have called a foul. We would have won anyway.
But like I said, talking real briefly. In fact, you mentioned St. John's. I know Chris Mullen. I think is Greg told me off camera is coaching them now. St. John's used to be such a storied, fantastic basketball tradition. They're 7-19. I don't understand they had obviously got a couple bad.
they've fallen into hard times,
I
think it's only Chris Mullen's first year back with the team, I believe.
All right.
Give him some slack. I think he'll get some recruits in there.
I sure as heck
hope
so.
Matter of fact, he did have a couple of good recruits. They're just not panning out quite yet. They're young. So but I remember the old Big East with Georgetown, Syracuse, UConn, St. John's. They were the powerhouse.
You know who used to be good was Boston College. Boston College.
Yeah.
Just
I miss the old Big East days.
Yeah, me too. There's no question about it. I mean, there's
the old Big East days, not the new Big East.
But obviously teams can bounce back. Because if you remember, Providence went through 10 years of dregs where they played. Now they're playing. They got some great players there. They got a good coach.
Sure.
And they're really moving forward.
And we're getting closer to March Madness, aren't we?
Yeah, and speaking of that, two teams that are suspended and cannot participate this year in March Madness are Syracuse and Louisville.
Yeah.
And they both have excellent teams and both having fairly decent seasons.
Mm-hmm.
But I guess it's got to be so difficult to try to keep run a clean program if you're a coach. Yeah. All it takes is one guy doing something he shouldn't be doing and
that
breaks loose.
Some of that Louisville story is really not meant for on camera.
Well, that's what I mean. I don't want to know about it, but just like, and I'm not even sure if Syracuse.
I don't even want to share
along.
It. But it's pretty
Syracuse
bad.
Syracuse has some ugly stuff going on too. But I just noticed that, and I also noticed. Remember George Mason? God bless him. They had a couple great, great years where they made it to the Final Four. The one year, they're like in the last place in their conference. I mean,
much fun about March Madness. You get these teams that were maybe 500 or something during the season, and they win their conference championship. They get to the end, get out a run and start beating teams.
That's what you get
to
play
for. That's so much fun to see that.
And I'll tell you what, North Carolina State, Pitt, those teams better start playing real well, or they're going to be playing in the famous NIT.
That's right.
Well, that being said, we thank everybody for showing up at Margarita Republic, and Greg has done a great job as always, keeping us focused and head forward. It's Bob and I are going to be heading off into the sunset now, but we will be back next week, and we're going to be doing some baseball talk because the season's just around the corner. We're going to make some predictions. You may not have known that.
Three more days, pitchers and catchers.
We're going to, and after a week in the spring training, we should know darn well who's going to win it all.
Oh, we're going to know.
I still haven't picked the right Super Bowl champion, and I had 15 different teams I tried to get by with, and I was 0 for 15.
We got a lot of comments to make on baseball. That's
Hey, so we will be back, and we're looking forward to it. We'll see everybody next week with another edition of Shots from the Bench. Thanks so much, folks.
Thank you.
Thank you.